Is Europe's far right going mainstream, and will their new ways win over public opinion? Let's get the views of our guests today. Joining us in London, Alan Mendoza, founder and director of the Henry Jackson Society. Gentlemen, thank you all. Welcome to Inside Story. Alan Mendoza in London, do you agree with Petros and Frank, who say that these changes that we're seeing within far-right parties in Europe are only cosmetic, that we're seeing a resurgence of the same old far-right, albeit dressed in new clothing, that the DNA of these parties hasn't really changed?
I think, firstly, we have to be just careful in our definitions. I mean, you mentioned UKIP in the same breath as the Front National. UKIP, although I'm no fan of UKIP, it's not set up in the same way that the Front National was originally done so. Equally, there are other parties in Europe, the Swedish Democrats, others who are, you know, openly neo-Nazi in terms of their actions. So I think there is almost like a spectrum of populist right parties that exist in Europe. Certainly those like the Front National that are trying to get away from their past, there are big questions as to whether it's cosmetic or real. I think, you know, only time can tell. Certainly the fact that Jean-Marie Le Pen is still around, even if he's been quietened by his daughter, indicates there is still some attachment to that very nasty past that we have seen time and time again. It's going to take, I think, some time for the jury to settle on where this current incarnation of the party is. And until that jury is settled, I think we have to be very suspicious of it.
Do you think that, you know, some people have said that this danger that far-right parties represent are sometimes being exaggerated. Would you agree with that?
Well, I think there is a danger from a disaffected section of the population who feel that, as was stated earlier, the mainstream parties are ignoring them. And when people feel ignored, they seek desperate measures sometimes. Now, it's fine if they're going to be supporting parties in the political process. What we don't want to see, though, is, of course, violence that often accompanies far-right parties from spreading in society and actually ruining social cohesion between communities. I think that's where the far-right parties are particularly dangerous, because they tend to breed this sort of aggressive form of populism with them that leads to violence and violence attacks on other citizens.
Right. France says that, you know, people are Frank says people are turning to the National Front in France because they're scared. Is this the same in the UK? I mean, if people, I look at the latest polls, and UKIP is predicted to do well in the upcoming elections, 8%, I believe. But is this why people are turning to UKIP in the UK? Is it because they're scared?
Well, it's a combination of factors, as Frank has suggested. I mean, fear perhaps is one sort of motivation. It might be fear of immigrants taking jobs, this sort of idea that people are coming here taking jobs from indigenous people. That's one argument. It may be that part of the echoes of the crisis of capitalism are playing out. This is almost where the far left and far right meet, actually. You get a lot of discourse now from far left and far right parties talking about a better economic deal. And it's clear that there's been some economic pain, and some people have reacted to that by lashing out, if you like, by supporting extremist parties of both far left and far right, has been pointed out as well. The other issue that matters, I think, in Britain and in some other countries as well, is a sort of feeling about the European Union. The way the European Union is unfolding is unpopular to many people in Britain and in many other countries as well, and people feel that the main parties are signed up, if you like, to the agenda, even if in the case of Britain that's not the case. Nonetheless, parties have seen the opportunity, and they have tried to, if you like, steal that slice of the vote by pledging to leave the European Union, for example.
Well, last year marked the first time that three far-right parties came first in EU nationwide elections. They were the National Front in France, which also won 25% of the vote in recent local elections, UKIP in Britain, which is currently polling as the third most popular party in the UK's upcoming general election, and the Danish People's Party, which is also Denmark's third biggest party. Alan, what about in the UK? Are conditions ripe, if you will, for a far-right leader like Nigel Farage to come to power one day or become one of the main opposition leaders in the country?
Well, we have a pretty unique electoral system that almost certainly prevents that from happening. What we have to do in Britain is you have to have strength in depth rather than across the country. Mm-hmm. So even though it's true that UKIP are currently polling third in the polls, their strength is diffuse across the country. It isn't concentrated. So it's likely that in the coming election, the Liberal Democrats, who will probably poll much less than UKIP, will actually end up getting many more parliamentary seats than UKIP. It's just the way the system works. And in a sense, our system has always been a good guard against extremism. If you look at the 1930s. We didn't have communists or fascists in parliament. Again, it was because of the political system here.
Can there be a common European response, do you think, to right-wing extremism or even left-wing extremism?
Well, it's difficult to have a common response because I think, as we've identified throughout the programme, there are different forms of extremism in different countries.
Right.
If you take what's happening in Greece, for example, it's different to what's happening in Hungary, it's different to what's happening in Germany, it's different to happening in France, and so on and so forth. So the idea of a common approach is going to be difficult to achieve. I think the one message from all this is, though, that it's about mainstream political parties responding to some fears. Now, some fears are clearly overblown and, you know, crazy. So the idea that Muslims are bad, for example, this is nonsense and has to be debunked. But of course, the idea that radical Islam is a problem for our societies in Europe is a very real problem, a very real threat. And in order to head off what the far right are trying to do, we've got to address the real problems and not allow them to take us onto the imaginary problem territory.
Right. You mentioned radical Islam, and I do want to touch on that briefly. You say this is the main problem today for Europe, radical Islam. So how then do you deal with it?
I'm not suggesting it's necessarily the main problem, but it is a real problem.
Right.
And you've seen, obviously, problems of radicalization. You've seen some of our citizens in various European countries going abroad. There are fears about social cohesion. Look, it's a multi-pronged approach to how you deal with this. There's two main prongs to it, though. The first prong is the official response in countries, making it quite clear that you know, radical Islam is not to be welcomed in our societies. And that can, you know, go through a variety of different approaches to try and, obviously, boost more moderates, to try and ensure that radicals are not included in discussions or receive money from the government in that kind of place. But the second approach has to be, of course, and is happening in the Muslim community. Muslims themselves are saying, this is not Islam that we recognize in the slightest. Mm-hmm. We have nothing in common with this. But the, you know, the next stage is for Muslims themselves to say, to actually drive out the radicals and say, you're just not welcome here in our communities anymore.
All right, that's a whole other discussion and debate, of course. Thank you so much for taking part in this edition of Inside Story. Petros Fasoulis in London, Franck Guillory in Paris, and Alan Mendoza in London.